If all 50 states went to war with each other, which one would win? Maine only borders one state. They'd blow up the highway bridge that spans the river into Maine. Only one highway interstate. There are a lot of good LA boys with lots of guns in Maine. They'd defend the border. The good LA boys would cover the land border and the coastal Mainers would cover the coast in their boats. Then Maine would probably just become a part of Canada. I could also see a version where Maine, NH, and Vermont, Northern New England, just break off and join Quebec together. California has ports. Supply from overseas. Try getting supplies from outside into Idaho or Nebraska. So anything we don't have could be shipped in easily from elsewhere. There were only 1620 highways that would need to be blockaded to stop easy access, and the Sierra Nevadas would be a strong natural barrier for anyone to cross. We have major Navy, Air Force, and Marine forces stationed here and a robust National Guard. The people with the most guns also happen to live along our border regions. If we were a nation, we would be the world's fifth largest economy. Texas and New York are up there, but not that close. Many other states would not even measure up to LA County or the Bay Area. California grows lots of food and has plenty of factory farms for meat, plus miles and miles of productive coastline. Our population is way bigger than most states, and many of our residents are former military. With our tech sector, not just Facebook. We also have JPL and many military tech companies. We could probably cripple the tech capabilities of rivals. We have multiple oil refineries, chemical plants, tire manufacturers, and other industrial assets that other states simply lack. In a we drop all the National Guards into a battle royale style thing. California has the largest National Guard and very sizable mechanized and air force, so they're probably the number one seed overall. For longer running war, the big thing is how stupid are people. For example, if we're not requiring a certain level of Warhammer 40k, everyone is dumb and there must be war style thing. The economic interconnections between areas are going to make regional power blocks form, like California, Oregon, and Washington are going to work something out to control all Pacific trade, most of the West's water, etc. Michigan, Minnesota, Wisconsin, and maybe Northern Illinois, after the Allegheny Civil War, form a polity likely that allies closely with Canada. Growing up in Michigan, the joke was our plan B was to just have the facilities guy take down the Stars and Stripes in Lansing and put the maple leaf. We just swear we've always been part of Canada. Virginia and Georgia probably squabble a bit over who is kind of the leading state in Confederacy 2.0. Texas hangs out on the western fringe of all that and has significant influence. California and Texas leave a strip of the southwest as neutral turf between them. Alot Island being left between British India and French Indochina to avoid border friction. If we have the everyone is dumb and there must be war, the first thing, of course, is we have to say no weapons of mass destruction. Way too many states have the option to just grab nuclear or bioweapons out of federal facilities and be like, hope you enjoyed Fallout, fuckers. So we have to say no WMDs. This, I think, heavily favors California. California invades Oregon and Washington, and Washington can't use the nukes off the SSBNs. Large portions of the coastal portion of these states probably welcomes the California troops, all those pesky Californians that moved there for cheaper living costs, etc. You end up where California is dealing with insurgency all along the eastern part of these states and perhaps even domestically in Cowboy California to a bit, but overall has food, water, and control over Pacific ports. Plus its eastern border is all mountains, desert, and low population states that need our food. Texas is the next closest in this scenario, but since we're in a there must be war grimdark kind of thing, they can't make logical deals with Oklahoma, whose population probably goes a suicide run against Texas, plus Louisiana and Arkansas. None of these players can take Texas down. But the whole problem is if Texas conquers their asses, now it has borders with Kansas, Missouri, more of the former Confederacy, etc. It can't really get itself to a point where it has borders that are as easy to secure as California can. It's permanently having some bullshit going on its eastern border. New York is the other big state, who of course now has a war going on with PA, another war with NJ, something going on with various New England states, etc. This is probably a whole clusterfuck where NY gets Ohio to attack PA from the west, so PA tries to get Michigan to invade and take Toledo back, so Ohio tries to get Wisconsin to invade and take the Upper Peninsula back. It's just a circle full of people putting knives in each other. I think Cali has the highest population, but aside from the crackheads, they wouldn't pose much of a threat. North Dakota, Maine, Minnesota, and Alaska could just dig in, and any invasions would meet the same fate as the Nazis did on the Eastern Front. Hawaii is remote and strategically insignificant enough that everyone would just leave them alone. Rhode Island and Delaware would just be swallowed instantly. Desert states like New Mexico, Arizona and Nevada would basically become deadlocks. Colorado would actually stand a pretty good chance with NORAD and several other military installations. The southern states would obviously be the ones to watch out for with all those trigger-happy rednecks, but I'd have to put my money on Texas and Tennessee. Texans of course have a lot of people and are better than everyone at everything, but they actually get along well enough with Tennessee ever since the Alamo. So Texas would probably offer an alliance and Tennessee would probably accept. Arkansas would probably be chill enough to join too, linking the previous two. Suddenly you've got an army of rednecks, hillbillies, cowboy cavalry, and some of the finest woodsmen in the nation fighting under one flag. Everyone else is screwed. Texas, we have lots of people, oil and guns, a strong economy, quite a few sizable military bases, a largely isolated power grid, and it doesn't get cold much. However, TX has a lot of border to defend, even if we assume Mexico remains neutral, and a lot of it is in fairly empty country. Oklahoma would be a pushover and would shorten our northern border a fair bit. We'd have to take it as a buffer zone before anyone else got their hands on it. New Mexico wouldn't be too much problem. We could probably just stop at the Rockies to have a defensible western border. Invading Louisiana is a non-starter, too much swamp to wade through. Arkansas and Missouri have much bigger problems with Key/TN/Seal on their doorsteps, but we could consolidate our gains, call ourselves New Texoma, and be in pretty good shape when the other big threats come calling. Probably a moot point though. I hear there are a lot of nuke silos in the Montana, Dakotas area, and those crazy bastards will use them and be kings of the rad zone. I have limited knowledge of the states as I don't live there, so I'll just go off of the numbers and the geography. Feel free to make any corrections as I'm also by no means a military expert. It depends really, since all 50 share the same military. How will it be divided? If we're talking equal divisions, Hawaii could be a contender since the only way to invade is by sea, but it's tiny, so if an invasion is successful, it would fall in a matter of days. A lot of mainland states would be out, especially the ones more in the center like Oklahoma, Kansas and Nebraska, as they would probably get pushed from all sides. Coastal states would probably make it to the endgame of the mainland brawl, particularly Florida, due to its position. The only way to get to it is either by sea, or a land invasion that forces you through a relatively narrow choke point, since the only adjacent states are Alabama and Georgia to the northeast. But my money is on Alaska. It's disconnected from the mainland, and connected to Canada. So a land invasion would be impossible like with Hawaii, but unlike Hawaii, it's also decently big, so it wouldn't fall too fast if it were to get invaded. However, if each state were to form their own military from their respective populations, then I'd have more money on the big boy population states with favorable geography like Florida and California, especially Florida. I'd still have money on Alaska, but not as much, since in a battle involving population, it falls short compared to Florida and Cali. Last I checked, they don't even have 1 million, while the other two have upwards of 25 million. TL:Drive, in my opinion, if the US military is split, Alaska wins due to its position. If each state makes its own military, Florida wins due to position and numbers. And we can't forget the Florida men and women. Who wants to bet some random is gonna come rushing at the enemy with a banana and a pet alligator? The East Coast would ally at first with Texas and Alaska to take out California. Alaska would do bombing runs and East Coast would use missiles. Texas would blitz across New Mexico and Arizona to create a buffer slash no man's land. Most ground fighting would take place there between California and the Allies, since it will eventually be a free-for-all. No one would ally with California. Once California falls, the rest of the states would start acting, probably start pummeling the exhausted eastern states and Texas. I mean, Texas. Probably, cause they got their own nukes, they got the space program, which means they are the ones having direct access to all those satellites. They have a population whom are largely self-reliant and knows how to handle guns so they can spring into action at a moment's notice. They have lots of farmland and natural resources, so they aren't going to lack food. They even got oil, so they can even be energy independent. Of course, there are two different states who has nukes, which is Texas and DC. So honestly, the battle would be between the two of them. But well, Texas or DC in a full-on battle. Texas with self-reliant gun-swinging cowboys and DC home of the rich elite who spends their days on the internet and asks for programs so the government may fix their overall problems. Texas. Texas. It has a big population, it has natural resources, it has guns, military bases, and it has the third lowest median age in the US behind only Utah and Alaska. Utah would have a tough time going on the offensive, as it is bordered by two of the biggest wild cards on the map in Nevada and New Mexico. Alaska could build up strong defenses, but it's not in a great position to take over other states. Texas should easily be able to conquer states like Arkansas and Oklahoma to get momentum going. Louisiana and New Mexico are potential problems, but they can't compete in the long run with the amount of money Texas has. I don't see Oregon mentioned, and I'm not necessarily throwing my hat to it. However, the geography has mountains blocking most of the state from other states with few interstates, and from the east, eastern Oregon is high desert, which also stands a threat. Plus, the people there, according to the rest of Oregon, are basically our Tuscan Raiders. Granted, Washington can basically wipe out the Portland area because the only border there is the river. However, the further south on the I-5 you got, the more valley you get, and that's where danger lies. To the west we have ports, but was also are pretty defensible because most of the coast is steep cliffs. During WW2, this actually was one of the reasons Oregon was defensible by most histories of the time. Hard to stage an invasion by sea if you are faced with cliffs. And if people get to the middle of the I-5, there's enough crazies and meth heads that it really just wouldn't be worth it, other than for that sweet, sweet timber resource. I haven't seen anyone mention Georgia, despite the fact it has the largest military base in the world, the busiest airport in the world, the Savannah Deepwater Port, and its geographic location makes defense relatively easy. The Chattahoochee River, which can be used to defend the western border, the mountains in the north can defend against Tennessee, and South Carolina is a weak neighbor and would only need a small garrison to defend against. That means that three borders with Alabama, Tennessee, and South Carolina would be easily defendable and would only leave Florida as a main threat. If Florida were to be annexed, Georgia could focus on South Carolina and Alabama, meaning that they could use the Appalachians as a shield against the other states, putting them in a good position. The only downfall I see is the lack of heavy industry, and Georgia would rely heavily on imports, and I don't think that Georgia would have a large navy, at least to my knowledge. Either way, states located in the corners of the U.S. would fare the best, since they would have less neighbors to deal with and wouldn't have to worry about a multi-front war, whilst states like Georgia with the right plans and tactics could easily come out on top. California. California has the highest population and would easily be able to annex its neighbors. The thing that would finally stop the California expansion would be Texas, but by then California would have already secured a massive chunk of land in the West Coast. California would win because it will be the state that actually ends up benefiting the most from this fight. Other high population states would of course annex their neighbors as well, i.e. Texas, New York and Florida, but I feel California would gain the most land. Texas would get second place in terms of land acquisition. I think everyone is forgetting that the federal government has military bases in all of these states. It would be the states against all four major branches of the military, who are inconveniently inside their borders. We've seen what a strong federal army can do against secessionist states, and the federal government has only gotten stronger since. The question really ought to be, how long would the national government take to put down 50 guerrilla-style insurrections after instituting martial law? How has only one other person petitioned for Texas? They probably own 95% of the country's guns. The state is huge, and it's hot and humid. The northerners would wither away from the heat. They'd go all Texan rage. And hypothetically, if Utah and Texas teamed up, it would be game over. Colorado, Utah superstate, CO has Cheyenne Mountain and a host of other key military things I'm sure we both know and don't know about. Denver is second place, I believe, in terms of federal presence. Utah and the Mormons have been preparing for the end since their very beginning. I expect Utah would have the upper hand, but the mountainous area helps both. I suppose my fanfic is Utah more or less taking over areas around it. Colorado may be first and a willing party or even partner. This is fun to think about though. Note: fun to live, I'm sure. New Mexico. Underneath the city of Albuquerque, New Mexico, is an underground nuclear weapons storage facility with the potential to house 19% of all the nuclear weapons in the world. The center, located at Kirtland Air Force Base, is reportedly the single largest concentration of nuclear weapons anywhere. Quoted from Wikipedia, I don't know if they win, but then that's something to consider. There's actually a book about the possible trajectory of the fall of the US. Can't remember the name. Maybe I'll find it later and link. That basically says the same thing. Essentially, because of the culture around self-sufficiency and being completely surrounded by rough mountains, Utah would come out above any other state, including Alaska. According to the author, the South would be the first to fall. Edit: I think the book is The Long Emergency by James Howard Kunstler. I was really into reading these kinds of book about 12 years ago and read a bunch in a row. But I think this is the one. Also, to clarify about Alaska, it wasn't because of anything other than this fact that they are so cut off from the continental US that they would simply be absorbed into Canada or become their own country. Michigan has choke points, strategic resources, industry that can be mobilized, and a large cohort of hunters and militia types. Use those forces as tactical irregulars and you could play some good delaying actions as the other states try and push in. I think Wisconsin would be smart to try and take the up, but the initial assault would be through small mountains and little strategic value would be gained. The southern border is a defense against Ohio, Indiana, and Illinois, who would all be fending off their own incursions and worrying about each other. The southern states all have a strong military tradition, with generations being in different branches of the military. They also have very relaxed gun control laws. making it much easier to form the already existing militias. And if the federal forts in these states would go to the states, then that arms them further. All that being said, I think Florida would be the victor. It has a large population, and borders only two other states it can trample easily, Alabama and Georgia. There's also the fact that it could easily trade with other nations. Finally, no one can beat the legendary Florida man.